Hey guys, let's talk about moment of inertia. Moment of inertia is a very important concept in engineering. It has a wide applications in the fields of dynamics, structural engineering, aerostatics, and stability of floating bodies, just to name a few. We always hear moment of inertia in structural engineering and in hydrostatics. To understand fully the idea and origin of the moment of inertia, you really have to go to the basic dynamics. To do that, consider this single pivot point and a lump of mass located at a certain distance and revolve it around the pivot point by attaching a rigid rod with the length of R so that the motion will look like this. It's very beautiful, right? Let us accelerate it at the basic rate of angular acceleration of 1 radian per second squared. To produce such, we need to induce a certain accelerating torque. Applying this torque will cause a tangential acceleration, which is equal to the radius times the value of angular acceleration. And taking note that the angular acceleration we are talking about here in this video is equivalent to 1 radian per second squared. This tangential acceleration will produce a reverse effective force due to accelerating mass, also known as inertia force. By nature, it's the same virtual force that tends to oppose or resist your pushing force whenever you try to accelerate things like, for example, if you're pushing a heavy car from rest. So you may ask yourself, why this force is called inertia force? Remember in physics, we say that a body has a lot of inertia if it takes a lot of effort to change its state of motion, which means a body at rest with large amount of inertia takes a lot of force to bring it in motion, and it will also take a lot of force to stop it. So you see that any body with inertia produces force if you try to change it's a state of motion. But what causes the inertia of a body? Of course, if you look at Newton's second law, the law of acceleration, force is equal to mass times acceleration, the answer is the mass. That's why in physics, mass is the measure of inertia. Massive objects with great mass are hard to move and also hard to stop. Going back to the free diagram, we know that if a force is applied at a certain perpendicular distance from a point, it will produce a torque or moment about that point. So by principle, this inertia force will produce a moment about the pivot point, in which we perceive it as a virtual resisting moment whenever we try to spin things or rotate things, especially if you are trying to do it in heavy objects. Say for example, try to roll a heavy wheel of truck. So rolling a wheel of truck is not easy because it is massive enough. It is a lot of inertia. And since this moment is caused by the inertia force, we can call it as moment of inertia force, or simply as moment of inertia, the moment caused by the inertia of a body. The moment of inertia is the moment of resistance. Whenever we try to accelerate rotationally an object at the basic unit rate of 1 radian per second square, the moment of inertia tells us the amount of effort to spin or rotate a body. The greater the moment of inertia of the body, the harder it is to rotate, and the lesser value of it means easier to rotate. To determine the moment of inertia, that is very simple math. Moment of inertia is moment, and you know for a fact that when we say moment, moment is force times perpendicular distance. So since this is moment caused by inertia, so the force we are dealing with is the force created by the inertia force, and the perpendicular distance is obviously the length of the rigid rod. So to get the inertia force from Newton's second law, that is mass times acceleration. And this tangential acceleration is simply equal to R alpha, or R times the angular acceleration, since we are dealing with the value of 1 radian per second squared here. Therefore, our formula will become mass times r squared. Considering our formula that moment of inertia is dependent on mass and its distance from the center of rotation. So it means the greater the mass and the farther it is from the center of rotation, you will expect a greater value of moment of inertia. So if you are wondering how much torque or moment is needed to give a body an angular acceleration value other than 1 radian per second squared, that is simply ratio and proportion. Say for example, you want to give an angular acceleration of 2 radian per second squared. Since the numerical value of moment of inertia is equivalent to the torque that causes 1 radian per second squared of angular acceleration, therefore, to produce 2 radian per second squared of angular acceleration, you simply multiply the moment of inertia by 2. If you want to have an angular acceleration which is equivalent to 3 radian per second squared, you simply multiply it by 3. So by this logical pattern, it simply follows that if you want to get the torque required to produce as n values of angular acceleration, that is simply equal to I times alpha. So moment of inertia multiplied by the angular acceleration you want to put, that is the amount of moment required to do that. The problem with the formula mr squared is that it is intended only for masses that is concentrated on a certain distance r. But we all know that in real life, 99% of the objects we encounter as distributed mass. When you say objects with distributed mass, these are objects in which the mass are not concentrated in a single point. So what are the examples? Basically, your body, anything you see, it's all about distributed mass. But in such condition, how do we find the moment of inertia? Let us say we have an object with its mass distributed, and this blue dot represents the center of rotation. So what you're going to do is you divide it into infinitesimal mass as shown. So the infinitesimal mass is represented by small squares here. Now let us consider a very small mass dm. Since dm is very small, we can just consider it as a concentrated small lump of mass located at a distance r with respect to the center of rotation. And this lump of mass will follow our formula r squared dm. And to determine the total moment of inertia, we should get the value of r squared dm of each infinitesimal masses. So to get the moment of inertia, you simply sum all the values of r squared dm. So if you are familiar with calculus, summing up infinitesimal terms is the same as integrating it. The concept of moment of inertia is best demonstrated by the rolling experiment. To perform this, you have two identical inclined planes, and at the top of each plane, you have a solid cylinder and a hollow cylinder with the same mass and same radius. If you release the two cylinders like this, you see that the solid cylinder will roll down faster than the hollow one. Why? It is because the solid cylinder has a smaller moment of inertia and the hollow cylinder has a larger value of moment of inertia. Thus, the solid cylinder is easier to accelerate and easier to gain speed than the hollow one. It is harder to accelerate and harder to gain speed because it has larger value of moment of inertia. So how did it happen? Why do this hollow cylinder has a larger value of moment of inertia than the solid one? Take note that these two objects has the same mass, though they have the same outer radius. Recall the formula that inertia is integral of r squared dm, or sum of r squared dm. In the solid cylinder, most of the mass is distributed near the center of rotation. And for the hollow one, most of the mass is distributed far from the center of rotation. Now, going back to the solid cylinder. Since the mass is distributed near the center of rotation, you can say that the location most of the R values of dm is smaller because it is nearer on the center of rotation. So smaller values of R for dm will result into smaller values of I, unlike in the hollow cylinder formula that integral of I is equal to integral of R squared dm. You can see that most of the differential masses are located further from the center of rotation. Therefore, it will yield to larger values of R distance for each values of dm. Therefore, larger values of R squared will result into larger values of I. The lesson here is the more you move masses away from the center of rotation, the larger value of moment of inertia we will have. Guys, basically, moment of inertia plays a crucial role in selection of proper structural members and beams and columns. This is also the reason why structural engineers prefer to use I-shaped steel section for long span beam. Also, moment of inertia is very important in analyzing the stability of floating bodies and for the geometric design of ship. So you better wait for my upcoming videos for other topics regarding the selection of section and for the stability of floating bodies. But let us focus about the dynamics part of moment of inertia. To give you some little application about this, it is said that one particular dam in China that is so massive, it changed the moment of inertia of the Earth. To explain how the Three Gorges Dam slows down the Earth by about 6 microseconds, we begin by understanding the concept of angular momentum. By the way, what is angular momentum? Angular momentum is a property characterizing the rotary inertia of an object or system of object in motion about an axis that may or may not pass through the object or system. So technically, angular momentum is also the rotational version of linear momentum. Of course, whenever you push something and it moves on a certain velocity, it will gain a momentum. So it's the same thing. Whenever you rotate anybody or if you revolve a certain mass, it will have a certain angular momentum. And in physics, angular momentum is expressed as moment of inertia times the angular velocity. When we say angular velocity, it tells us how fast an object spins or rotates about its center of rotations. Look at the formula. So L represents the angular momentum, I for moment of inertia, and omega for the value of angular velocity, meaning the greater the value of angular velocity, the faster it spins. The lower the value of angular velocity, the slower it spins on its axis. Another thing to consider is the law of conservation of angular momentum. It says that when no external torque acts on an object, there will be no change of angular momentum. So, angular momentum will be inertia times omega will be constant. To further explain this, imagine this spinning wheel. If there is no external torque, this rotating wheel will continue spinning forever, maintaining its angular momentum. So if you want to stop it, you better apply a certain torque. So say for example, if this wheel of truck is rolling, so to stop it, you better apply an external torque. And most of the time, the external torque is produced by the brakes. It is the same reason that our planet continuously spins in its axis ever since, because its angular momentum is conserved. The influence of gravity imposed by heavenly bodies such as our moon and sun has too little effects as for now. So if you're looking on Earth, this has a constant angular momentum. Definitely it spins ever since. So if you want to change the angular momentum of the Earth, that's kind like science fiction. Say for example, you may call on Superman to do it for you. Or maybe there are some alien technology that can produce a torque that can literally change the angular momentum of the Earth. Now, let's talk about the Chinese dam. The construction of gigantic dam shifts large amount of water mass at further distance from the Earth's center, resulting into a little bit larger value of moment of inertia. And we learned that increasing the distance of mass from the center results into a larger values of inertia. So you know that if you make the value of R larger, you make the value of inertia larger also. So meaning, in a simple sense, the Chinese dam increased the moment of inertia a little bit by increasing the distance of mass from the center of the Earth. Going back to the fact that the angular momentum of the Earth is constant, and rearranging the formula, therefore we can say that the angular velocity of the Earth is simply angular momentum of Earth all over the moment of inertia of the Earth. But since the moment of inertia became slightly larger than the original because of the shift of mass, therefore make the denominator larger, you will have a smaller value of angular velocity. When you say smaller angular velocity, meaning the slower it will get. But do not worry, the effect on the rate of rotation of our Earth is very, very insignificant. So by this time, that Chinese dam has no effect on the Earth's rotation. So furthermore, to explain that idea, it is the same idea with the figure skater. Look on this figure skater on the right. Of course, the figure skater here is spinning faster. So, but if the figure skater moves out her limb, she will rotate slower. Why? Extending her limbs allows some mass to be moved away from the center of mass, thus resulting into a larger value of inertia, thus slowing her down. I hope you learned something in my videos. Comment if you want to know more or suggest topics we can discuss. See you on my next video.